Today we want to discuss the quality of tolerance in our lives as devotees of the Lord. And I think the topic is so nice. When Prabhu gave me the topic, I thought this is a topic, you know, worth dropping all other things for and spending time on. So you created a nice opportunity for me also. And how to develop this quality of tolerance is very important, actually. So let's try and understand this from Srila Prabhupada and from scriptures, because that is the safest way for us to grow in devotional service. Om Agnyanati Mirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Milit Yena Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha Jai Ananta Koti Vaishnavada Ki. We all, ever since we came into devotional service, I think if there's one quality that we have always heard that we should cultivate in our spiritual life, it has always been tolerance. Even the Sikshashtakam, Trinarapi Sumichena, Tarorapi Sahishnuna, we can understand from that shloka, which we are all familiar with, how important it is to be tolerant. And the end result of tolerance, right, comes to the point where we can all chant Krishna's names constantly. So tolerance is very, very powerful. And without tolerance, we will understand in our own lives that it is very difficult to make advancement in devotional service. Frankly, personally, I found that every time I have lacked tolerance, the situations before me have been very bewildering and things have been very difficult. So this is a very important point. Tolerance in Bhagavatam actually means to forbear. The word forbearance is used in Bhagavatam, right? If you read 1.18.48 of Srimad Bhagavatam, which we will look at later, you know, the word forbearance is used. And therefore, to tolerate actually means to forbear, to withstand. So what are we forbearing and what are we withstanding? Actually, if you look at Bhagavatam, to tolerate means to forbear or withstand something which is either very difficult to give up or something which is very difficult to accept. Actually, if you think carefully, that's what tolerance is really about. It's the level of strength that we have to forbear or withstand something that's very difficult. Tolerance always implies there's some level of difficulty. And this difficulty comes not only because we have to give up something, but sometimes to embrace something. In life, I think we will know we have to give up something. Isn't it true? It happens very often. You know, it happens very often. Krishna gives us the best snapshot of this giving up and accepting in Bhagavad Gita. In that famous verse of 2.14 of Srimad Bhagavad Gita, Krishna tells Arjuna, Matra sparsashtu kaunteya, si tushna sukha dukkha daha, agama paniyo anityas, tam stitikshasva bharata. Titikshasva is actually known as tolerant, tolerating. And in that shloka, Krishna tells Arjuna very early in the Gita that the non-permanent appearance and disappearance of happiness and distress, they are like what we call the appearance and disappearance winter and summer seasons. Why does Krishna concentrate on happiness and distress? Because that's often what we are always in between in our lives. All of us, even today, right now, we are either in between a happy situation or a distressful situation. Hopefully right now you're all very happy because we're talking about Bhagavatam. But at some point of the day, you will always have to be in between these two. Krishna is telling Arjuna, because Arjuna is trapped. He doesn't want to fight, but at the same time, there is a higher duty that he has to accept. And so Krishna tells him that, oh, son of Kunti, right? He tells him this non-permanent appearance of happiness and stress. So one thing we can learn how to develop this quality of tolerance, and that's really important, is to understand that the nature of this world is that whatever we tolerate, thankfully, is temporary. It is temporary. Why? Because the nature of the world is temporary. Sometimes, you know, people tell us, you know, that my life is full of difficulty. But the good news we tell them is the miseries are temporary. They cannot last forever, thankfully. They may last for a long time, but they won't last forever. And sometimes people come and tell us we're very happy. And we gently remind them that happiness is also temporary. And that while you're very happy, be appreciative, but it will not last also. So the ability to accept this happiness and distress as one, be temporary, and two, as Krishna says in 2.14, they arise from sense perception. This is a very important point. Krishna tells Arjuna, they arise from sense perception, O scion of Bharata. So therefore he tells Arjuna, learn to tolerate them without being disturbed. So that is the meaning of tolerance. When we tolerate something, right, the important thing is while we are tolerating, if we are disturbed, actually it is not tolerance. If we are trying to tolerate something and we are completely disturbed, then actually we've lacked the ability to tolerate. That's also something sometimes we don't think about. It is difficult, but when we tolerate with higher principles of Krishna consciousness, the difficulty is manageable. It may be difficult, but it's manageable by the mercy of Krishna, by the mercy of devotees. Prabhupada writes in the purport of 2.14 that one must learn to discharge duties according to understanding and tolerating that the appearance of happiness and distress is non-permanent. The moment we can accept that, Prabhu said, Matis, that is the first step, even without us realizing it, to be able to tolerate something. Prabhupada says, you know, in the purport, just like a wife or just like a woman does not hesitate to cook in the fierce summer, especially in India, it's really hot, isn't it? Actually, now everywhere is getting hot. Nowadays, there's no summer, winter. Anyway, you know, things can become very hot and things can become very cold. But we will not stop the discharge of our duties. Therefore, when we have a duty to perform something, it becomes very important that we tolerate the onslaughts of happiness and distress. So Krishna gives us the hint of a very important point. If we want to develop a quality, any quality, not just tolerance, we must understand what prevents that quality from arising in our hearts. Think about it. When we want to develop a quality, it's important to understand what is preventing us from actually having that quality in our hearts. When we understand that, then we can develop it better. As an example, tolerance will come in our hearts when we realize, right, that duality in this world exists as a principle. If we cannot accept that this world is dual in nature, it will become very hard for us to tolerate. And then we must understand why we are in this dual world and why we are caught by the duality. It is because Bhagavatam says of our forgetfulness of Krishna. So as long as we are not Krishna conscious, then our material existence will always be oscillating between sense perception and speculation. And Krishna says in 2.14 of Bhagavad Gita, it is sense perception that makes us that gives us the inability to tolerate, actually. So this is a very important point. If we just read Bhagavad Gita very quickly, this verse, we won't catch it. But we have to think carefully about this. And that is why 11.2.49 of Srimad Bhagavatam tells us the nature of this world. And until we understand the nature of this world and the nature of our body, it will be very difficult to tolerate. It's like you go into a game of chess. You expect a chessboard to be there, isn't it? Suddenly they take out a board, you know, for backgammon, for example. You know, I don't know who plays backgammon now, but when I was young, I used to play backgammon. So they had these boards. If you turned it this way, it was a chessboard. If you turned it that way, it was backgammon. Now, if you accept that we are going to play chess, you must have a chessboard. But if you're going to play backgammon, you can't play it on a chessboard. And because we cannot accept that this is backgammon and not chess, we can't tolerate. We say, no. This cannot be it. This cannot be it. And half of our life goes because we cannot understand what is the background of this material world and what is the nature of this material body. That's why tolerance becomes very difficult. In 11.2.49 of Srimad Bhagavatam, one of my favorite verses, it is so nicely stated by I think it is the Navayogendras. Dehendra prana mano diyam yo Janma Pyayach Vayatarsha Kritche Samsara Dharme Avimuya Manaha Smriti Bhagavata Pradhanaha. It's a beautiful verse. The meaning is very nice. It is stated that in this material world, our material body is always subject to birth and decay. That we have to accept. Notice it is not birth and death. In the word-to-word transliteration, the word apya, you know, janma apyaya. The apyaya is translated, if I'm not wrong, as diminution, right? Diminution. It means deterioration. Actually, death is easier because when death comes, it's over. It's very final. But when something is deteriorating, it's very difficult to accept and tolerate it. That is why old age and disease are more difficult to tolerate than birth and death. Birth, you know, we are not conscious. So thankfully, we just are born, finished. Death, you know, the path leading to death is deterioration. But death itself is a single moment. That is why in Bhagavad, the word death is decay. Decay is what makes it very difficult for us to tolerate this world. Because things decay, things deteriorate. If you have a nice relationship with a devotee, but on account of misunderstanding, the relationship deteriorates. It's very hard to tolerate that pain of a relationship going south. It's very painful. It's difficult to tolerate that. So that is why the word decay is used. So in this material world, our material body is subject to birth and decay. Our life, prana, is always harassed by hunger and thirst. We don't realize it, you know, as devotees, we have so much prasadam, so we're fine. But many people find it very difficult to tolerate hunger and thirst because it's constantly coming. Then the verse tells us our mind is always anxious. That is true. It is always anxious. And to tolerate that anxiety becomes more difficult when we cannot accept that chanchal or anxiety or moving up and down is the nature of the mind. If you cannot accept it, it's very difficult to tolerate it. And then, this one I like, intelligence runs after that which cannot be obtained. It's so interesting, isn't it? In this material world, very often our intelligence is misused. So mind tells you, I want to run after something. And intelligence should be telling you, this is out of my league. But no, the mind will give you the favorable arguments. No, you have to do all this. And you will run after it. But you will never get it. And you cannot tolerate the difficulty and frustration that comes. That is why, you know, it is very difficult if mind and intelligence cannot be controlled. And ultimately, kritche, all our senses, right, become exhausted because of this constant struggle. Now, Bhagavatam tells us, a person is not bewildered. A person who is not bewildered by the inevitable miseries of material elements and existence. Inevitable. This is the starting point for our tolerance. We must accept that this nature of the world is inevitable. This world will not change for us. The world will not tolerate us. We have to tolerate the world. This world is a creation of the Lord. We cannot tell the Lord to change the nature of the world. We desire to be in this world. We jolly well tolerate the world. It's a very simple transaction. And if we can't, we will constantly be frustrated, even while performing devotional service. Because we'll always think, this is not fair. Why did this happen to me? I've taken up devotional service. I should be smiling. Even the great devotees in Bhagavatam, their whole life was filled with tolerance, isn't it? But even while tolerating, they could remember Krishna. So how to develop qualities of tolerance? To first understand the inevitable nature of the world. This is an important point. And if someone understands that, if you look at the third line of the shloka, samsara dharme avimuyamanaha. This is the dharma of this material world. Just like you and I have different dharmas, isn't it? Some of you are fathers, mothers, sons, daughters. You know, we all have different occupations. The nature of this world also has its own dharma. And this dharma is very bewildering. Avimulya manaha is bewildering. It is not bewildering to smritya harehe bhagavata pradana. To a devotee who is considered to be completely, right, remembering Krishna, that devotee remains aloof from this material world. He or she is in this world, but they are not of this world. That's a very important point for us to remember. So the great devotees of the Lord, they are living in this world. They have lived in this world, but they always recognize the nature of the world and they respect the nature of the world. It's very important. We have to respect the nature of the world. So when we develop quality of tolerance, we have to understand the nature of this world. Otherwise, we'll become perplexed because sometimes we will accept some things and sometimes we will reject it. But we don't realize in accepting and rejecting that is also part of our life here. Prahlad Maharaj confirms that in 7.9.17 of Srimad Bhagavatam. Yasmat priya apriya viyoga samyoga janma sokagnina sakalayo nishudaya manaha dukkhaushadam tadapi dukkham atadhyayam bhuman brahmami vadame tavadasya yogam. 7.9.17. Now, when you have time, look it up. Prahlad Maharaj is singing a beautiful prayer to Narsingadev. And he says, O Supreme Lord, because of this combination of displeasing and pleasing circumstances, and because we are sometimes with these circumstances, sometimes separated from these circumstances, we just move around in this world in the most regrettable condition. We move to the hellish planets, we move to the heavenly planets, but all the time because we cannot accept that this world is full of acceptance and rejection, we are always lamenting. And then Prahlad Maharaj says something very important. Dukkhaushadam tadapi dukkham atadhyayam. The material miseries of the world, they are very bad. But the solutions to the material miseries, which are materially based, are often more worse than the miseries themselves. They are much worse. Now, just now I heard about devotees being sick. You would know. If you go to the doctor to treat one sickness, he gives you a medication. Then he'll give you a second one. You'll ask him, what is this for? He'll say, if you take the first one, there's some side effect. So you take second one to stop the first. When you think of it, it's actually some kind of madness. But that's life. Devotees don't cry and roll on the ground in pain because of that. We just accept it as part of life and move on to chanting and doing our devotional service. We have tolerated it. So sometimes you have to tolerate. And that's why Prahlad Maharaj is saying that you please accept that the nature of the world is to accept and reject. One day, a devotee in the congregation will be your best friend. Another day, because of whatever that may happen, through no fault of both of you, you may not be the best of friends. I've seen so many devotees, especially in my job as, you know, general counsel to ISKCON. 90% of problems, they come down to relationships and deterioration of relationships and the lack of acceptance of devotees, right, of each other's natures. Because we cannot accept and tolerate each other, everything goes south. And that's why, you know, Prabhupada insisted that we must learn to tolerate. This is a very important point. So please understand that even though you're a devotee, this world still remains as it is in the, as described by Krishna in the Gita. It is still Dukkhalayam. It is still Ashvashutam. This is the nature of the material world. Some devotees tell me, no, I thought that when I became devotee, nature of material world won't apply to me. There won't be Dukkhalayam. There won't be Ashvashutam. But as long as you have this sharir, you are in this world and you have to accept it. Threefold miseries we have to accept. The four junctions of life, birth, death, in between old age and disease, we have to accept. You remember the beautiful story of Buddha and one lady called Gautami? Gautami came to see Buddha because her child unexpectedly died of a high fever one night. It is the most painful experience any parent can feel at the loss of the child. When she heard that the master Buddha was in the vicinity of her village, she actually brought the dead child with her, carried the dead child and brought it to Buddha and laid the dead child at his feet. And she told him, Master, I've heard that you can conduct great miracles. Please revive this child because you have the potency to do so. Buddha looked at her and smiled. And then he told her, I will do so, my child, but do something for me. You please go into your village now carrying your little child, and ask each house and beg for only mustard seeds, nothing else. The only thing is, in each house that you beg for mustard seed, that house must not have known birth, death, old age, or disease. If you can find a house like that, then please come back and see me, and your child will live. And so she left, eager, knowing with certainty that if Buddha had given her a lifeline, there must be a lifeline. And so she went to all the village. By evening, she came back, but she did not look forlorn, neither did she look sad. Gautama attained realization of the nature of the world. She placed the dead child at the lotus feet of Buddha, and she told him, "My dear master, I understand today why I had to go into the village to do this task. It was not meant to revive my son. It was meant to revive my consciousness and to make me understand that we have to tolerate the onset of this world. That is the only way to become peaceful." Such a beautiful, simple story, but it tells us how important it is to develop this quality. So this is a really important point that we should remember. Not only Gautami had to face this difficult time. If you remember in Bhagavatam 6th Canto, Chitraketu Maharaj wanted a child so much, isn't it? And in the end, you know, his child, that precious child, was murdered by the other envious queens. And in the morning when he saw the child was lifeless, Chitraketu Maharaj lost all desire to live. He swooned and his kingdom swooned with him. Narada came back to see him with Angira. And Narada then preached to Chitraketu Maharaj and gave him the signs of the soul and the signs of self-realization. When he gave him that, then only Chitraketu Maharaj could tolerate the onslaught of the misery of separation from his child. Only when the child was revived by Narada Muni, and Narada Muni said, "Wake up, living entity who possesses this body, wake up now and see your father who is yearning for you." And the little entity, the child woke up, but the soul is ancient. And it replied to Narada Muni so wonderfully, "Narada, which father are you talking about? And in which life?" And when Chitraketu Maharaj heard that, he was completely thunderstruck. It just hit him at that point that the nature of this world is something he never understood and he could never accept. So this is a very important point that we should remember. The faster we accept and realize the nature of the world, the more we will develop capacity to tolerate it. Respect the nature of this world. You will realize in Bhagavatam, 70% of Bhagavatam actually discusses the material manifestation. Isn't it so? A small portion of Bhagavatam discusses the spiritual sky. Why? Why so many times in the first, second, third, fourth, fifth canto, we keep hearing about the material manifestation and the nature of the material manifestation? Because our acharyas and Krishna want us to realize that this world is to be respected and to be tolerated. But in order for us to advance in Krishna consciousness, we must access this transcendental knowledge of this material world through the serious and scrutinizing study of Srila Prabhupada's books. Bhagavad Gita as it is, Srimad Bhagavatam, Chaitanya Charitamrita, and all the wonderful books that His Divine Grace has given to us. By studying Srila Prabhupada's books, and by doing exactly what you're doing now, taking association of the sadhus who are present today, this is what will give us the strength. This will give us the illumination with which we can use to tolerate this world. Speaking of sadhu sangha, you remember Narada Muni in the first canto, how he was speaking about his past life to Vyasadeva, and he told him that, "I was not just the once, you think I am the great Narada Muni, but I'm not. A long time ago, I was a little boy to a maid servant. You know, I was of low born birth and no wealth of education or high parentage. But by the mercy of the Bhaktivedantas who came and stayed with us for a few months of Chaturmas, I took their association. I got the remnants of their prasad. And because of that, Their devotional service was so powerful, they blessed me with their sadhu sangha. They gave me the strength to tolerate this world. And how do we know Narada as a little boy tolerated this world? We know it because as soon as the Bhaktivedantas left and he was under the care of his mother, one night his mother went out to milk the cow and she was bitten by a serpent. Did Narada Muni roll on the ground in grief and in pain? Did he curse Krishna and Bhaktivedantas? You all just came. Everything should be auspicious now. And my mother dies barely 2 weeks after you have left. In material world, we think that way. We think the moment devotional service comes, house must be nice, new car must come, money must drop from the sky, there'll be upgrades to our jobs, we'll get nice son-in-laws and daughter-in-laws. I had a devotee who said, I was expecting after taking up devotional service, I'll have a nice daughter-in-law. But she's a daughter-in-law from hell. So what has happened to my devotional service? But that's the point. Devotional service gives us the ability to understand that in this material world, this samsara dharma will continue. If it didn't continue, Prabhu and Matajis, you have no incentive to leave this world. Krishna wants you back in the spiritual world. So tolerate this and become Krishna conscious. Without tolerating, it's very hard to become genuinely Krishna conscious. We could chant, but there will be some unhappiness. There'll be some expectation, some unfulfilled desire, some icha, and these grow as offenses, and they become, you know, what we call, they become the creepers, and they affect the bhakti lata bij, our devotional creeper. This is how sometimes we don't realize why Srila Prabhupada gave us books, and why he gave us sadhu sangha in the form of ISKCON. Because without these two pillars, it's very hard for us to tolerate this world. Very hard. Narada Muni, as a small boy, he got both. He got sastra through the sadhus. And that gave him tolerance when his mother left the world. He saw it, Bhagavatam says, as the hand of providence. As the hand of providence. And he went away to the forest and perfected his life. See how powerful was his tolerance. Another great example is Dhruva Maharaj. Dhruva Maharaj in the fourth canto, if you remember, Suruchi insulted him, isn't it? Called him so, told him such terrible things. You can't sit on the lap of your father because you have not been born in my womb. So if you want to even have a chance, you pray to the Supreme Personality of Godhead that in next life you are born into my womb and then you have a chance to sit on your father's lap. Like that, she told him. And so Dhruva Maharaj was very, very upset. And he went to see Suniti. Now, Suniti, if she did not tolerate it, have you been in situations where someone whom you love very much becomes hurt by somebody and they come and tell you how painful it was? Your initial reaction is counteraction. Let me pick up the phone and fire the person, isn't it? That's the first reaction we have. But that's exactly what we shouldn't do. Suniti, when she heard what Dhruva Maharaj said, she was very upset. She was upset. Bhagavatam says she was upset and she was even angry. But then, because she's a devotee, she tolerated the anger. Why? Because she had higher knowledge. You see, with higher knowledge, the tolerance is easier. She was also breathing heavily, Bhagavatam says. If you want, you look. It's 4.8.17. 4.8.17. Dirgam swashanti vijinasya param. Dirgam means heavy. Swashanti means breathing. So nicely, Bhagavatam says that Suniti was breathing very heavily. You breathe heavily either because you're going to, you're not well, or you get angry sometimes and you breathe very heavily. And she did not rid her son off of the painful situation. She did not know it. Dhiram swasanti vrijinasya param. Apashyati balakam ahabala. She had no idea. She didn't know what to do. But she gave the best advice to her son. Ma mangalam tata pareshu mamsta bhungte janayat paradukkadasta. Very important verse for us. She said, because she couldn't find a material remedy. She couldn't find a material remedy. She said to her son, my dear son, Don't wish anything inauspicious for others. Sometimes when people hurt us, if we don't tolerate, we also want to hurt. If we don't hurt them, in our minds, we are hurting them because we mean inauspicious things. I hope that, you know, something will drop on his head, lightning will strike him. But outside, we say, Hare Krishna Prabhu, it's all right. No, it's still the same thing because you're feeling it inside. So Bhagavatam tells us, Suniti tells the mother, he tells the son, don't wish anything inauspicious for others. Why? Anyone who inflicts pain upon others suffers himself from that pain. So we don't have to be unduly worried. Instead, we should follow what Suniti said. In 4.8.19, just after that, Suniti gives the best solution and the best way to tolerate this world. Atishtatata vimadsarastvam uktvam samatapiyat avyalikam aradayat dukshajapada padmam yadikshasedhyasanamuttamaya. Meaning is very beautiful. She says, my dear Dhruva, whatever has been spoken by your stepmother, it was very harsh to hear, I agree, but it is factual. Can you imagine? She actually agreed with her. It is factual. Which part is factual? The part about taking darshan and meditating on Supreme Personality of Godhead. And she told Dhruva another important thing. You accept that at this moment, right, Suruchi, your mother, your stepmother, is more in favor of your or by your father than I am. Accept it. So Uttama will be able to sit on the lap. You can't sit on the lap. Accept it. But give up your envious attitude. Don't be envious of your brother. And don't be angry. Just execute the instructions that she gave. And what was the instruction? Just engage yourself in worshiping the Supreme Personality of Godhead. That's all. That's all. That's what we have to do. So a devotee's outlook is very different. You know, they are able to tolerate things because of this higher knowledge. I remember there was one devotee. You know, he was going to be imprisoned because there was some issue with the law that he got in and was some difficulty. He was a good devotee, but he got himself into trouble. So he approached my spiritual master and said, you know, that Maharaj, now I think I'm going to be in jail, you know. And he was really, really down. Maharaj said, it's all right. Krishna was in jail anyway, you know. So our parampara is, if you're in jail, just tolerate it for a while. Do your Krishna consciousness. Accept that you have made some mistake. Repent. And when you come out, you just tolerate the difficulty and push on with your Krishna consciousness. So it's how we accept this world. It's a very important point. And this can come when we are alone. In the hallowed Sangha of the great devotees of the Lord. See, Dhruva Maharaj had Sangha of who? His mother. Chitraketu had Sangha of Narada Muni and Angira. Narada Muni had Sangha of the Bhakti Vedantas. You see how each party gives Sangha to other. It's so important. Prahlad Maharaj, he had Sangha of Narada Muni when he was unborn, when he heard Srimad Bhagavatam. Amazing, isn't it? Therefore, it is very important that we must seek association of devotees. And when Krishna sees us taking shelter of devotees, then he becomes very, very pleased. We all know that. Krishna says, Bhakte Bhakta Jana Priyaha. What to speak of my devotees? Even devotees of my devotees, very, very dear to me. And Prabhupada says, you know, in a beautiful line in the purport, I wrote it down in my notes the other day. Prabhupada says, the Lord is so kind to his devotees that when severely testing him, the Lord gives him the necessary strength to be tolerant and continue to remain a glorious devotee. Can you imagine that? So actually, when we just try to tolerate, Krishna actually helps us. He gives us the extra boost. He gets us past the finishing line of intolerance. And he gives us strength. Our spiritual masters also give us the strength when we tolerate the material world. They become very happy. I think the purport is 8th canto, 22nd chapter, 29-30 verse. You can find it there, actually. It's a very important line, and it gives a lot of assurance to devotees when we are trying to tolerate this difficult world. A lot of assurance, actually. Bali Maharaj was the best example. How much was tested by Krishna, isn't it? He was made humiliated. He was made to look like a fool, promising 3 steps of land and not being able to deliver. Thinking that Vamandev had feet this small when he was actually the Lord. But even then, even at the point of his humiliation, Bali Maharaj tolerated the humiliation because he tolerated the difficulty of this world. When his demon friends came and wanted to fight Lord Vamandev, he told them, "Stop, my friends. Don't even try fighting. Why? Because your time is not right. There was a time when we did very well. But now, by the Supreme Personality of Godhead's will, this time is worse." A devotee learns that some days he has good times and some days he doesn't have good times. But in all days, he has Krishna. In all days, a devotee has Krishna. And that is how we grow in our tolerance of this world. Very important. So, Sadhu Sangha, reading and studying Srila Prabhupada's books. And I think this group is very, very concentrated on doing that. And that's why I just love speaking to all of you. And thirdly, developing icha, a desire to actually cultivate tolerance in our heart. It is stated by Srila Prabhupada and the Acharyas in this world that actually no one can prevent you from desiring. And no one can become desireless. Prabhupada says that in the 6th canto, 16th chapter, 34th shloka in the purport. Prabhupada says, nobody can be desireless, no one. But the living entity is always running after desires that they cannot fulfill. That's the problem. So we should develop a desire to become tolerant. If we don't develop a desire to become tolerant, Krishna will not see that we are putting in sincere effort. There must be effort. Where there is endeavor, Krishna becomes very happy. Mercy is always falling. This is Purushottam Mass. The month of Purushottam, she surrendered to Krishna. She was abandoned. She had nowhere to go. But she went to Paramparayanam, the source of all shelters. And when she surrendered to him as Sharanagati, the most important thing she had in her mind and her heart was a desire to fall at the feet of Krishna. So desire is ours. It's our monopoly. That's the beauty. Krishna never takes away our desire. He never controls our desire. But desire is ours to give to Krishna. It is the only thing that we have, actually. This desire is the manifestation of our free will. It is a manifestation of our free will. So we must develop that mood. When we develop it, we'll become peaceful. And this wonderful point of tolerance is also given in Bhagavatam in another beautiful episode between Prahlad Maharaj and the Avadhut. In the 7th canto, 13th chapter, 42nd verse, Prahlad Maharaj was wandering as a king when he came across this wonderful, great personality. And he's known in Bhagavatam as the Avadhut. And so he saw this Avadhut was very interesting. Some days he lived like a king because people gave him a lot of opulence. Some days he lived like a pauper because nobody gave him anything. But on both days he tolerated. And he remained peacefully engaged in Krishna consciousness. That is tolerance. So Prahlad Maharaj became curious and he said, "Avadhut, how do you survive this? One day you are like a king, next day you are like a pauper. How do you tolerate this? It's very difficult. It's mind-boggling." And he gives a very, very good piece of advice to all of us. "Naham ninde nachastaumi." Ninde means, you know, to blaspheme, right? "Naham" means no. And "cha staumi" means to praise. So there is praise and there is criticizing or blaspheming. "Naham ninde nachastaumi swabhava vishamam janam. Ete sham shreya asha se utai kadmyam mahatmani." The translation is beautiful. Different people are of different mentalities, full stop. Let this be the slogan with which we should live, and we will tolerate. Just put it up near your bed when you wake up, in your office, in the kitchen, wherever you're going to meet people, you just put it up there. And every time someone works in a funny manner, you just say, "Different people are of different mentalities." And what if different people are of different mentalities, what are we supposed to do? The second line, the Avadhut says, because different people are of different mentalities, therefore, it is not my business either to praise them or to blaspheme them. Sometimes, you know, devotees, we like to praise other devotees, but if we are not careful, we overpraise. And we glorify, glorify, and glorify. One time, Bhakti Rasamrit Maharaj told me, Devaki, do you know in Shastras, it is stated that over-glorification of someone will lead to eventual criticism of them. Because I was trying to glorify Maharaj before he took the class. Then he took me away and said, no, that was over-glorification. I said, sorry, Maharaj, I didn't mean it that way. But he said, yes, you must be very careful. You must be equipoised. That is the meaning of neither praise. We see good qualities in everyone. We should not come to a point where that praise leads eventually to envy. Because sometimes when we plead, Prabhu, you sing so nicely, so nicely, so nicely, eventually, oh, I should also sing like that and I become envious. We should be careful. That's why Bhagavatam says, neither blaspheme nor praise. If you don't blaspheme and you don't praise, what should you do, devotee, then? We should serve devotees. That's what we should do. When you serve devotees, you don't get caught in praising for the sake of praising. Neither do you get caught in blaspheming. You are just serving them. And serving devotees is genuine. It is the best way to relate with devotees. Always see them as always befitting service. Always see humanity as befitting service. Very important. And that's what he says here. I only desire their welfare. You see, if we desire someone's welfare, it translates automatically into service. And in that service, automatically tolerance will come. We understand different people have different mentality. We have to tolerate. It's natural in this world. Don't criticize them. Don't take too much time to praise them. Serve them. Desire their welfare. This is the platform for genuine tolerance and for being very kind. Now, one more point that's really important. Swayambhuva Manu advised Dhruva Maharaj in the fourth canto, 11th chapter, I think 13th verse. He told him a very practical point. Why? Dhruva Maharaj became very upset when his brother Uttama, if you recall, actually was killed by a yaksha. He could not tolerate it. He could not tolerate it. And he became very upset. And he decimated the population. He decimated the population of the entire yakshas until Manu had to intervene and say, my dear Dhruva, it does not become you to behave this way. Why are you so angry? Do you not know that the hand of Krishna is in this matter? And then he tells him in 4:11:13. It's a nice verse. Titikshaya karunaya maitriya chakila jantushu samadvena cha sarvatma bhagavan samprasidati. The Lord becomes very satisfied, Manu is telling us, with his devotee. When the devotee greets other people with what? The first quality that comes forward is tolerance. It's tolerance. Because from tolerance will come mercy. From mercy will come automatically friendship. And from friendship will come equality. So the foundation of mercy, friendship, and quality, as given by this verse, is actually tolerance. It's the foundation. Without tolerating, it's very hard for us to be even kind to others. How to be kind with someone if you cannot tolerate and understand their situation? Isn't it true? Understanding someone can come only when you tolerate. Otherwise, it's very difficult. So this is an important point. Prabhupada says in that purport, right? The Titikshaya Karunaya verse. He says, everyone by constitution is a devotee and eternal servant of God. Therefore, it is the devotee's business to awaken everyone's Krishna consciousness. Therefore, that is his mercy, Prabhupada says. And it cannot manifest without tolerance in our heart. It cannot. So our worldview must change. Our attitude must change. Our perspective must change. We must become convinced through Bhagavatam that everyone is part and parcel of Krishna. And how important it is not to tolerate them, but to tolerate our own mind and senses when we speculate about them. Sometimes we forget that while we are tolerating everybody, We become proud. Oh, I can tolerate everyone. But we forget how many people are tolerating us. Isn't it true? While we're moving around this world oblivious and thinking we're tolerating everyone, only Krishna knows how many people are actually tolerating us. So the word tolerate in Bhagavatam is not the same as the word tolerate in the material world. In material world, if you tell someone, I'm just tolerating you, that means actually I'm angry with you. But for other considerations, I'm just holding on. As soon as I find a chance, I will fire you. That's what tolerance actually is in material world. But in spiritual world, it's very different. When we say, I tolerate, I'm trying to tolerate, we're not saying that we're tolerating that person. No, we are tolerating the urges of our mind and our senses to find fault with that person, to find fault with the situation, and to find fault with the nature of this material world. That is what tolerance is about. It's inward looking, even though it appears to be outward manifesting. You see, for it to outwardly manifest nicely, internally it must manifest first. That's why in, 11.7.37 of Srimad Bhagavatam, there the example of Mother Earth is given. Bhutai akramyamano api, dhiro daivo vasa anugai, tadvidvan na chalen margan, anvasiksham shite vratam. A sober person, even when harassed by other living beings, should understand, very important, should understand that his aggressors are acting helplessly under the control of God. And thus, he should never be distracted from the progress of his own path. This rule I have learned from the earth. This is about the 24 gurus, you know. And the first guru that the Brahmana speaks about is earth. Is earth. And Prabhupada says the earth is a symbol of tolerance. Learn from earth. The earth, deep oil drilling is going on. Atomic explosions have taken place. Pollution in the land, in the sea, in the air. Constantly harassed by all of us. Lush forests are cut down. Always waste land are laid, lands are laid to waste. Sometimes the earth is soaked by blood. And the earth continues. Bhumi Devi continues to supply us with necessities. She never says, no, I'm going to go on strike now. Nothing for all of you. No resources for you. She tolerates. She tolerates so much. Another example Shastras give us is the tree. A woodcutter sits under the tree because it's very hot. He gets full shade of the tree. And after getting the shade of the tree, he cuts the tree down. But the tree tolerates. It doesn't deny the woodcutter the shade of the tree, even though it very well knows that shade, the woodcutter may not reciprocate its tolerance. Tolerance is from within. That's why we don't wait for others to be tolerant to us. We tolerate because then we are growing in devotional service. Why wait for others? So if we understand from 11.7.37 that actually all living entities who harass us are harassed by material modes of nature, and they are. Sometimes, you know, you're in bad mood. Sometimes material miseries are getting to you. Sometimes, you know, disease is afflicting you. You're not yourself. You may not come out very well. But if we understand they are harassed, and that's why they are harassing us, then we stop thinking ill of them. Isn't it so? We stop meditating on them, and we meditate on Krishna. The more we meditate on Krishna, the more Krishna gives us the strength to tolerate. So Krishna is so kind that he himself is the example for Mother Earth. Why? Because even though in this world, half the world does not believe in Krishna, maybe more. And then the other half is filled with demons. Yet throughout the history of the material manifestation, Krishna has never stopped water, food, oxygen, any necessities from being given to even a demon. He tolerates everyone because he sees them in their right perspective. Otherwise, all the demons should be choking now because Krishna has withdrawn oxygen from them. But they're not. All the demons should have no money in their banks because the devotees are working hard for Krishna. Frankly, I know non-devotees who are doing better materially than devotees actually. You know, they're doing very well. They don't believe in Krishna. They say to hell with Krishna. But Krishna is so kind because he tolerates them. Because he understands that this is their nature. But he never stops trying to spread Krishna consciousness. This is a very important point. That is why, and I want to conclude my time with you, that is why it is stated that tolerance starts from our urges. We have to tolerate our urges. Pacho vegam, manasa krodha vegam, jiva vegam, udara pastu vegam, etan vego no visheta diraha, sarvam api mam prithivim sa shishya. It's so clearly stated by Rupa Goswami in Nectar of Instruction that a sober person who can tolerate the urge to speak, the mind's demands, the actions of anger, and the urges of the genitals, the belly, and the tongue, such a person is qualified to make devotees all around the world. This is so important. So we have to learn, instead of tolerating everyone or expecting others to tolerate us, let us learn to tolerate our senses. Let us learn to tolerate our urges. And Bhagavatam is full of great devotees who tolerated their own urges. Parikshit Maharaj became upset, if you recall, with, what's his name? Shamika Rishi, right? And he put a garland of dead snake on him. But the moment he did that, he realized that his counteraction was wrong. And he repented. Then he heard that he was going to be cursed by Sringi Brahmana. That was the sequence of events. But when he heard that, he did not counteract. Instead, he saw that as a great boon. He tolerated his mind's urge because he was strong enough to actually counteract it. It is stated in Bhagavatam 1.18.48, something I mentioned right at the very start. Tiraskritta vipralabdha shapta shipta hata api na asya tad pratikurvanti tad bhaktaha prabhavo pihi. The devotees of the Lord are so forbearing, forbearing means tolerant, that even though they are defamed, even though they are cheated, even though they are cursed, even though they are disturbed, even though they are neglected, even though they are killed, they are never inclined to avenge themselves. Because if you try to avenge yourself, there will always be a resultant action. Why waste time? So Parikshit Maharaj decided, never mind, let the curse come. I now have 7 days notice, right? Very good. Most of the time, we never get 7 days notice before we die. Very often, we don't even know when we are going to die. So what did he do? He immediately dropped everything. He sat down on the banks of Yamuna and he greeted all the rishis and munis and he heard Bhagavatam from Shukadev Goswami. He would never have been able to do that if he did not tolerate the curse that came to him. And that's why he chants so beautifully in 1.19.16 of Srimad Bhagavatam. Punascha bhuya bhagavate anante rati prasangas chatat ashrayeshu mahat suyamyam upayami shrishtim maitrastu sarvatra namo dvijebhyaha. See what he says there. I pray that if I should again take my birth in the material world, I will have complete attachment to the unlimited Lord Krishna, association with his devotees, and friendly relations with all living beings. That's what he wants. And he knows he can achieve that if he tolerates. If he tolerates. And before this verse, he says so nicely that Krishna has so kindly come in the form of a Brahmana's curse. He saw Krishna. He tolerated the situation and Krishna gave him the ability to see. So therefore, a devotee tolerates at the cost of his own convenience. Very important. When we tolerate and we are put into inconvenience, Krishna becomes pleased with us. He did not kill Sringi Brahmana. He didn't counteract Shamika Rishi. No. Lord Shiva is another example. When Daksha was finally killed by Lord Shiva was approached by Brahma. But Lord Shiva was very peaceful, actually. He was not inclined to avenge Sati's death on account of something personal. But he says in his prayers that he wanted to teach Daksha a lesson in Bhagavatam, to teach him that what he did was not right. And when Lord Shiva appeared before Daksha, Daksha begged forgiveness and chanted beautiful prayers. But the important thing is, Lord Shiva tolerated the impudence of Daksha in such a way that he actually gave him benediction. So sometimes we may have to be firm with some devotees. Sometimes we may have to tell a devotee, Prabhu, you can do this, but you can't do that. But that doesn't mean we're not tolerating them. It just means we are trying to show them the path. But if we are driven by a lack of intolerance of them, and then we try to advise them, my experience is they never take the advice well, because they know that our mood is not correct. And there is some malice or envy or some politics in our heart. So even in a subtle point like that, tolerance becomes very important. Unknown to us, whether we like it or not, people can see whether we are tolerating on account of love and understanding or we are not. They can see that and they can feel that. And the best example to end is the example of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. When Amogha, the son-in-law of Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya, came and he saw that Mahaprabhu was eating food fit for a king, at the request of Bhattacharya, not because Mahaprabhu wanted to eat, what did Mahaprabhu say? No, what did Amogh say? Amogh said very loudly, what kind of sannyasi is this Mahaprabhu? Huh? He actually thinks he's a sannyasi, but he's eating food like a king. And he did that twice. And both times Bhattacharya wanted to beat him up with a stick, but he ran away. And Bhattacharya became so upset that he begged forgiveness from Krishna. And he cried and cried. Krishna told him Chaitanya Mahaprabhu told him a very nice thing. Mahaprabhu just smiled at him and said, actually, I don't know why you're speaking about blasphemy. What fault is there in what Amogh said? There's no fault. He was speaking the truth. I am a sannyasi. Why am I eating like a king? Is there anything wrong with what he said? It's not defamatory. It is truth. I should not be eating like this. Mahaprabhu taught us how to tolerate on the basis of transcendental knowledge. If someone is speaking the truth, there's always going to be a grain of truth to anything someone tells us. It may not be completely truthful then, but find the truth. Find the truth. Where there is smoke, there must be some fire. So don't see criticisms, don't see suggestions, don't see advice from devotees as criticisms. Tolerate. Try to understand why the devotee is saying that. There must be a reason for it. When we do that, we become peaceful to chant Krishna's names. In conclusion, I just want to emphasize that tolerance itself is not very astonishing. If you read Bhagavatam, the austerities that Hiranyakashipu did, how much he tolerated his senses is unmatched. But he's Hiranyakashipu still. So tolerate is itself not astonishing. But do you tolerate your senses to use them in the service of Krishna? He tolerated his senses to achieve something for himself. But if we tolerate our senses and our urges to serve the devotee, to serve Krishna, then we will actually become good servants and good instruments in his hands. We will tolerate it in such a way that we will be kind and we will be forgiving of each other. Because without tolerance, one cannot become kind. And without tolerance, one cannot forgive and one cannot forget. Jai Granthraj Srimad Bhagavatam ki. Jai Shla Prabhupada ki. Jai Shla Gurudev ki. Ananta Koti Vaishnavrinda ki. Jai Gaura Premanande. Thank you, Amrish Maharaj Prabhu and devotees.
Thank you very much, Prabhuji. What a wonderful and inspiring lecture. And whenever I hear your lecture, I always wonder how you are able to actually create this garland of various different verses, and they are so relevant. And when we actually personally, when we are reading Srimad Bhagavatam, personally, I can mention about myself, when I'm reading, I will just pass over that verse without even understanding the insights that you are actually mentioning. And just like the flowers are there in different plants, but when you actually put them together into a wonderful garden, it looks so beautiful. So thank you very much. It was very, very inspiring and insightful for all of us here. The devotees have already started raising their hands, but before I go on to their question, please allow me to ask one question as well.
Yes.
Prabhuji, very important insight that you mentioned, that generally when we talk about tolerance, we talk about tolerating someone else, but mainly we have to tolerate our own anarthas and urges and desires. So how do we actually make that transition now that we are trying to tolerate others, and now we want to move from that focus from outwards to inwards? So yes, what you have mentioned now, that is a beginning, but how we can actually do something more practical after we have understood this?
I think the most practical way to imbibe something that is given to us on the basis of Bhagavatam, Prabhu, is actually to dwell on it for a while. We should dwell on it. This is known as contemplation. That's why, you know, in Bhagavatam, the word contemplation is used very often. Brahma contemplated, and then he began his prayers. You find many times great devotees contemplated, and then they begin their prayers. Contemplation means that we should think about these things for a while. We should meditate on them. We should pray to Krishna to give us some enlightenment, some realization on these points. I find the longer our mind dwells and our heart dwells on these points, the more Krishna will give us the knowledge and realization by which we can come to him, Prabhu. And that Krishna says also in Chatushloka of Bhagavad Gita, right? He says, you know, that, you know, I will give the intelligence to those, you know, who are devoted to me. It's so important, actually. So the intelligence is not for us to be able to translate. But if we try very hard in our devotional service and contemplate on these ideas, then the experience of Bhagavatam is that Krishna will actually give us the intelligence, or he will create an environment where we will remind each other of these things and we will grow. I hope that is useful, Prabhu.
Yes. Thank you very much, Prabhuji. Kirtivanta Prabhuji, please go ahead with your question.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji. Dhamma pranam.
Hare Krishna.
Prabhuji again for a very nice class.
Nice to see you, Prabhu. Yes,
you too, Prabhuji. And I hope to see you when you're in New Zealand, Prabhu. Please come to my home. Sorry, Amrishmaraj, yes. Prabhuji, for the quick invitation on the message. Prabhuji, yes, Amrishmaraj Prabhuji said, you know, you've put all of these verses so nicely on a garland. Unfortunately, I wasn't able to take them all down. And there's one verse that I'm missing, and I was wondering if you can mention it again, or at least the verse number. It was in Canto 7, Chapter 9. I think it was the second one you may have mentioned.
Is it 7917, Prabhu, Prahlad Maharaj?
Yes, that's the one. Yes, the Prahlad Maharaj one.
Yeah.
And also you mentioned the devotees of the Lord are so forbearing that basically no matter what happens to them, they don't retaliate, right? What verse is that, Prabhu?
1848, Prabhu.
1848. Excellent. Thank you, Prabhuji. They were all very nice verses to, as you say, to contemplate and to keep in mind the way to apply tolerance. Thank you very much, Prabhuji.
Thank you, Prabhu. Hare Krishna.
Prabhuji, is it okay to have the other questions as well? There are two more questions.
Oh, yeah. I think Manmohan Prabhu has a question.
Yes. Manmohan Krishna Prabhu, please go ahead. Manmohan Krishna Prabhu.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji, Dandavat Pranam.
Yes.
Dandavat.
Prabhuji, my question is, thank you for wonderful class about the tolerance. What are the practical tips you can give to tolerate a kid?
A kid, okay.
Because it's affecting, because outerly I can control, but when it comes to their naughtiness and something like that, sometimes I tend to lose my anger. So how we can tolerate in that situation? And sometimes their angerness, my frustration pull out somewhere else. So
I'm assuming this child is your child, Prabhu, and that's why you have to tolerate.
Yes, Prabhuji.
The first thing we have to accept is Krishna has given him to you. Whatever it is, for good or for bad, he is yours. That's one. That's your quota now. Right? And second, there's a reason why he has come into your life. If he has to give you hell for a while, you just tolerate it, Prabhu. Probably you gave him a lot of hell in previous life also, and now we're just carrying the accounts. That is also another important point. But the third, more deeper and more serious point is, children are given to us so that we can serve them. Krishna gives us children so we can serve them. They're not ours. They come from Krishna. So if we have the outlook that we want to serve him, serve them, then Prabhu, we can tolerate, you know, sometimes their mischief, their naughtiness. But please remember one thing. Tolerance is not a sign of weakness. Tolerance doesn't mean we cannot, you know, discipline someone. Tolerance doesn't mean we cannot put our foot down and say no means no. If they cross a certain line that they shouldn't be doing, whether it is, you know, children or devotees under you or in your workplace, you'll have to draw the line. To tolerate to the point where you cannot serve someone is a weakness. That's why tolerance itself is not astonishing, Prabhu. It has to be used in the right way. So I have two children here. I tolerate them as much as I can. But sometimes when they cross the line and they're doing things that they should not do, it is my duty not to tolerate at that point. But I should tolerate my senses in how I come out to them, Prabhu. That is important. If I just lash out at them because of anger as a reaction, they won't hear me. They will just get, you know, the relationship will not improve. But if I can tolerate my senses and sit down and explain to them why this is not right and be firm and not budge for certain things, they will start to understand that Father cares for us. It's not that they don't care, but there is a line that we cannot cross. So is that helpful, Prabhu?
Sure, Prabhu, I'll try this thing.
Try. You know, the good thing in Krishna consciousness is we cannot guarantee the results, but we can always endeavor. We can always endeavor. Just try and pray to Krishna, contemplate, and he will give you the strength.
Okay, thank you so much.
Sure.
Thank you, Prabhuji. Sudharma Mataji, please go ahead with your question.
Yes,
Prabhu.
Hare Krishna.
Very happy to
see you.
Prabhuji, very, very amazing picture. So many points. I didn't have time to note so many, like verse after verse, the way you were saying. And we are amazed to see how you could remember each and every purport as well, what Prabhupada had said and giving it to us. Like a nectar. My first thing will be like, we read Bhagavatam as well, but it's like not like the way you intensively you are actually looking at points and telling us or advising us. So how to first actually have that ability to read like Bhagavatam? I think we are lacking a lot. We are not getting many points, what you have said. So one thing I wanted to get some advice as to how intensively we can actually scrutinizingly study Bhagavatam rather than just going through or for the reading sake. And another question will be also like in Bhagavatam, when there is one instance where the bull is actually like, you know, the Kali, when the leg was hurt, he's asking the question, like, who caused this? Yes. And he actually, that's a tolerance, like, you know, where he's not actually
absolutely
identifying who actually caused the pain to him. So that is like Bhagavatam, whatever examples we see, when we relate to our personal lives, we feel like this is not possible at all. Like, you know, how we elevate ourselves to that level, like, no, even we, you know, the cause was who has caused the pain for us, but we are not actually ready to show or identify them. That is a totally different level, Prabhuji. Like, can't contemplate on this thing. So give us some tips, like how to actually even look at those situations. Thank you.
I look at the first one as well as I can. I think to Bhagavatam, Prabhu and Mataji, we don't have to worry so much about how much we can cover Bhagavatam, but just read daily in such a way that, you know, you keep a notebook with you, you take a shloka, you look at you chant the shloka, then you look at the word-to-word meaning. The word-to-word meaning is very important. And then you look at the translation. Sometimes what is captured in translation is not in the word-to-word. Sometimes the word-to-word meaning will enhance the translation. So that's why Prabhupada gave us the word-to-word, to be read actually. And when you look at that, you look at translation, then you take out the nice points that touches your heart. A particular verse in Bhagavatam may touch my heart because of my situation. But there'll always be a verse in Bhagavatam that'll touch your heart based on your situation. And when you see that verse or you read that verse, take it out, write it down, spend a week studying it. Sometimes I just take one shloka, which I find very important. I take a whole week to study it. I chant it for the whole week. I read it. I write down some realizations. I contemplate upon it, driving, in between my work, in between court. So that way you steal time. When you add up that time, you realize that you have actually taken a lot of time to think about Bhagavatam. You don't have to have a straight shot of time if you can't do it. But take a verse, study it. There's a verse that doesn't appeal to you, read it, no doubt. Read it, study it. But if there's a point that is very practical, take it down. Then go back to your notes, study your notes. And at some point you'll find that because you're working so hard for Bhagavatam, Bhagavatam will reciprocate, Mataji. Bhagavatam is alive. Bhagavatam is Krishna. Bhagavatam will reciprocate. There's never been a time Bhagavatam has never reciprocated with us. He will reciprocate. So that's my first point. The second point is the examples of tolerance are so high in Bhagavatam for two reasons. One, the personalities are really exalted. And two, they set a standard that we should try to achieve. But we should not lose hope. We should, in fact, be enlivened that actually it is possible to reach that height of tolerance because the devotees have shown it. And we pray to these devotees and that one day we can tolerate that way. Even if we cannot hit that level of tolerance, just by desiring to follow in the footsteps of the acharyas, we will move from one point to another point, which is already progress, actually. Which is already progress. So never be discouraged by the greatness of the devotees. They have set a bar. But at the same time, anything that we do from now to that bar is already pleasing to Krishna. Is that helpful, Mataji?
Definitely, definitely, Prabhuji. Thank you so much.
Thank you. I think we have one last question.
Yes. Thank you, Prabhuji. Omkar Prabhuji, please go ahead.
Yes. Hare Krishna Prabhuji, Dandat Pranam. Thanks for
Dandavad.
It was a very nice eye-opening class. Prabhuji, my question, in the class you mentioned that even while testing, Krishna gives us the strength and makes us that we cross the line. And he makes the devotee looks glorious while testing us. So how do we understand this more deeply? Because this was very touching for me too.
I think a good example is Bali Maharaj. Bali Maharaj actually was told by Sukracharya, don't give the three steps of land and don't listen to what Vamandev wants. And so because he didn't want to hear Sukracharya, he was denounced and cursed to lose everything. So at that point, he lost everything actually. Because once you lose the blessings of your guru, you lose everything. But despite that setback, Bali Maharaj tolerated the fact that he will lose everything. But he did that because he really wanted to serve Vamandev and he had given his word at the cost of anything to himself. And so when he did that, Vamandev, instead of reciprocating and blessing him, made it worse for him. Made him look like a fool that he lost everything because he wanted to test how far his tolerance will be. Bali Maharaj at that point of time, right, accepted the fact that Vamandev is Krishna and he surrendered Atma Nivedan. When he surrendered, Vamandev gave him the ability to withstand the difficulties before him. Vamandev's blessings saw him go through that difficult episode. But Vamandev did not take credit for that strength. Vamandev gave full credit to Bali Maharaj. That is the beautiful nature of the relationship between devotee and Krishna. Krishna gives credit to devotee even though he's really behind him. See, Arjuna was very powerful during the Mahabharata war. After Mahabharata war, in the first canto, 15th chapter, Arjuna tells Yudhishthir Maharaj that after the war, my chariot, my bow, my arrow, my horses, they're all the same. But I, Arjuna, have lost all potency. So he could understand that the potency for his success was coming from Krishna. So actually, this proves to us that when we try, even a little bit of attempt, right? Swa alpa, even a little bit, Krishna becomes so happy that we are tolerating and that we are trying, that he will give us the strength to move from one point to another. Otherwise, we'll become proud, Prabhu. And if we cannot tolerate our pride, then we will lose Krishna consciousness. Is that helpful, Prabhu?
Yes, very helpful, Prabhu. Thank you so much. Hare Krishna.
Sri Ramchandra Prabhu is from Bangalore. Hare Krishna. Ambarish Maharaj Prabhu. He used to be in Abu Dhabi for many, many years.
Hare Hare. Please go ahead. Hare
Shall Prabhu. I take one last question? Is that okay, Ambarish Maharaj Prabhu?
No, please, Prabhuji. We are eager to hear more and more. As much as your time permits, please, please go ahead.
Hare Krishna Prabhu.
Prabhu, yes, Prabhu. Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna.
Thank you, Prabhu. So nice. Because I just want one question. Question means in the scale of 10, is there any measurement that up to maybe 8 or 9 only we should tolerate? Is there anything specified that to this extent we should tolerate? Beyond that, I cannot. That's the question.
I wish there was, Prabhu. It would make our life so much easier, you know. Krishna says, okay, 5, beyond 5, now forget about tolerance. Before 5, we just relax, you know. The thing is, because we are living in this material world, everyone, right, will have to measure things by themselves. It's very difficult. That's why we're in this material world. It's very difficult. But with association of devotees, in Srila Prabhupada's books, Krishna will give us the answers. How much to tolerate, how little to tolerate, when to tolerate, who to tolerate, and what to tolerate. He will. That's why we're all together, Prabhu, so that we can bounce off ideas with each other, look at Sastra, Guru, and Sadhu, and we will come to some kind of understanding. That is the way. Otherwise, this material world, you know, I wish it was like that, but it is not. And when we accept it, then we will be able to deal with it better. I think it's an important question. Yeah, it's a sobering question. Very sobering question. Thank you, Prabhu.
Thank you very much, Prabhu. Hare Krishna. Thank you, Ambarish Maharaj, for giving the opportunity for the questions. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Prabhuji, for taking out your very, very valuable time, and especially as you mercifully change your schedule just to accommodate this lecture and to give us...
Actually, Prabhu, I'm thankful to you. Because of you, I could move everything. So I'm happy. Thank you for giving me such nice association.
And we are looking forward to have your personal association here. Yeah. And and we will be able to serve you as well. So thank you very much. So let us show our appreciation and gratitude by loudly chanting Hare Krishna Maha Mantra for His Grace Devakananda Prabhuji.
Hare Krishna, 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 Hare